started real quick. I'm sort of on a time crunch here. I've got all the very patient skit performers here. Yeah, very patient skit performers. So let me go real quick. Just a card. We're so grateful for such a loving church family. Thank you for the beautiful shower, every gift. Most of all, the love and support you've shown us during such a special time in our lives. We covet your prayers. We continue this journey of marriage. We love you all. Caleb and Angelica, it's good to have them back this week. Just a couple things. I know that it was last minute. Many of us have put in a ton of hours during the park this week. So what I'm asking, your Sunday school parties, New Year's party, whatever, we're going to move those to next year. January the 1st, all right, will be some of your Sunday schools that ask about having a Christmas party. We'll continue on. Next Sunday is Christmas. Our service will be here at 10 o'clock. Please bring your family. Come worship with us. Miracle Marietta tonight, 4 o'clock is when we'll meet at the pavilion. We need everything ready. If you can't do the roll you did last night, get with me. We should have cups, snacks, everything we inventoried last night, I believe. Our crowd control, we got to sort of make some adjustments there. But other than that, I think everything is good to go. If you didn't get a chance to help, want to come help, golf cart drivers, standing, talking to people, telling people which way to go, all those things. Pace, I need you as a wise man tonight. Thank you for volunteering. I just saw you sitting back there and you got a beard. There you go. Other than that, I'm going to get out of the way. Let's see, January 1st. I think that's it. If you are using the fellowship hall, do not turn the controllers off like we normally do, because it's supposed to be like 9 degrees. Usually we keep everything turned off at the church, but this, we're going to keep everything on 50. So if you're over here working, you turn the heat on, don't turn it off when you leave, just turn it back down to 50. Same if you use the fellowship hall, if you come play ball or you come for dinner or something, leave everything on 50, especially during this cold weather. Other than that, hey, I want to lead us in prayer. One of you guys want to pray? Yeah. Okay, you do? You think you can open us in prayer? You think so? All right, let's go. You ready? Lord, we thank you, God, for these children. Thank you, God, for an opportunity to worship you today through them. Thank you for the sweet little voice, God, that, God, I know you heard. I thank you, God, for an opportunity to serve you today. In Jesus' name I pray, and all of us said, amen.
baby Jesus, bum-rum-bum-bum-bum. I am a poor boy too, bum-rum-bum-bum-bum. I have no gift to bring, bum-rum-bum-bum-bum. That's fit to give our King, bum-rum-bum-bum-bum. Shall I play for you, ba-rum-bum-bum-bum, on my drum? Mary nodded, ba-rum-bum-bum-bum. The ox and lamb kept time, ba-rum-bum-bum-bum.
We'll take just a second here to fellowship. Make sure our little animals, you see them. Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you. I'm sorry, Lacey. Thank you. Yeah, you have the floor now. All right, let's stand together. Let's fellowship real quick. Anthony's going to play us something. We'll fellowship through real quick. Tell somebody Merry Christmas. Glad to see them.
Herald angels sing glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is
Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. His name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end.
Thank you, children. Got tore up in a prayer circle this morning, and then the children started making me cry, and so I was trying to get them off the stage. I didn't want to keep crying, but it is good. What a great spirit. I'm telling you, it's just good. If you were here in 2021, you probably realized I preached on the wise men. I didn't realize that until I was going back and studying, and when I saved my notes to my computer file, it popped up wise men 2021. I'm like, but God, all week, actually my mind has been on King Herod and preaching from his perspective, and then it moved to the wise men. And so throughout being at the park and being here and running, Kenny and I survived one of the greatest missions this week. I know we've had a lot of challenges of making hot chocolate, of getting people in place, of getting animals where they're supposed to be. I told her, I said, I would never, unless it was for God, want to go to Tupelo on the Friday. And we went to Ollie's, Sam's, Walmart. Did we go anywhere else? Oh, we went to eat at the Love Coffee Shop. Oh, yeah. That started today, but if you're willing to fight Tupelo traffic, man, you need, something's wrong with you. I mean, I don't know what's going on here, all right? But, and of course, I wasn't going to the red lights. I told her I can beat all these cars, which meant, you know, you got stuck. And anyway, it was just, we just had a date night gathering up everything and for the show, but it is good just to keep working. We've got two more nights. I pray that God give you a little rest this morning, and that we can knock out this next 48 hours. I know I've talked to Brother Jeremy this morning already, and no complaints, which is a good thing. And I don't mind complaints as long as they make things better. I don't like complaining because it's too cold outside or whatever. It is what it is, right? And let's just keep doing God's work. But today I ask you to turn to Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 2. I've studied all week Matthew chapter 2, which I've spent a lot of time in commentary on Matthew chapter 2 this week. And actually looking at King Herod, I know you see Herod the Great, and Herod was a very wicked man. Matter of fact, he ruled about 41 years, from about 37 B.C. to 4 A.D., 6 A.D., somewhere in there. Herod was on the throne. And you'll see, if you go back, Herod was one that's not mentioned a lot of times, but he had the entire Sanhedrin executed, the ruling board of the Jewish church, or the Jewish law at the time. He also murdered, you've read where he's murdered his wife, he murdered his son, he murdered the heir of his throne, which would be his son, and the next heir of his throne. He murdered his wife's grandfather. He murdered about 3,000 to 4,000 people. Anybody that he thought was sympathized with the Jews, he would murder. He basically went in, and if you were a friend of the Jews, he murdered you. He wanted all the loyalty, and you were either loyal to him or he had you killed, and thus his name, Herod the Great, not necessarily because he was a great leader, but he was greatly known for his evil doings. For 41 years, he ruled the state, if you will, of Israel. And so I begin to look at this perspective, but as evil as this may sound, and as evil as this man was, the history books tells us, I believe with all my heart, according to the Word of God, the man believed the message from God's Word, and he also believed the messengers. But I can identify with that because many years of my life, I believe the message and I believe the messenger. But there's a difference between believing with the mind and believing with the heart. Today we're going to understand that. One of my children showed me something. Well, I'll get into that in a minute. Let's stand, if you have a copy of God's Word, Matthew chapter 2. We're going to read here in verses 1 and 2. Matthew chapter 2, verse 1 and 2. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there was wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born of the king of the Jews? We have seen his star in the east and come to worship him." Father, thank you for the reading of words. Now I pray that you would translate your words, Father, from your word that you have given us, God. I pray you would translate that into a message that I need, Father, a message that will help me in my personal walk, a message help me as a father, a message that help me, Father, as a pastor, a message that will help me as a Christian, Father. I pray you would give me a message, God. Let the correction start with me, Father. I pray that today, God, that you would speak to me, and God, let me take that message and speak, God, to those that are around me, to those that may be listening at home, to those that are sitting here this morning. God, use me as your mouthpiece and your messenger. And Father, I praise you, God, for the children, God, and their message this morning. I praise you for the worship. I praise you for the prayer time that we've already had, God, just gathering around and sharing hearts. God, I know you show up when we get humble and we remove ourselves. I know, Father, you will increase as we begin to decrease. I know, God, you will begin to move through the pews and speak loud and clear to our spiritual ears and hearts if we would simply be willing to accept your message. Lord, I love you today, and I thank you for an opportunity, God, to speak on your behalf. Forgive me where I failed you, but now I pray, God, your name shines above all names, God, that you get all the honor and glory here this morning. That'd be my prayer. In Jesus' name, and all of us said, amen and amen. So you look at Herod, what did I see? Well, again, I sort of alluded to it there. The very first thing God began to see, there must be more than a mind knowledge to find Christ. Herod is also wanting to find Christ after the announcement of the wise man. And so if you're going to find Christ, there has to be more than a mind knowledge. If you look closely there, again, I believe Herod believed the scriptures. I see him going into action. I see Herod believing in the word of God. The problem is, again, I see him believing with his mind and not with his heart. I started to share with you a story about the kids. Kobe, let's see here. Well, can I pick on you this morning? Sure I can. Hold out your hand like this. All right, now don't you hold your hand like this. I need you to participate, all right? You see what's in my hand? What's in my hand? A cricket. See that cricket? Watch him. He's going to do some back jumps. All right, ready? One, two, three. Did you see that? You did. Good. My cricket's getting hot because he's done three back jumps, right? Can you hold his coat for me? Let him do another three. Can you hold his coat? Thank you. All right, watch carefully. One, two, three. You still see my cricket? You really believe there's a cricket there? Then why are you holding his coat? Huh? You know why he was holding his coat? Because you believe him with your head, but in your heart, you knew there wasn't a cricket there, right? It's the same application. When we hear the word, "Mr. Larry, did you see my cricket?" All right, all right. It's the same application. All my life we believe with our mind and we believe we're doing the right thing, but friend, if it's not in your heart, when trials and when everything starts surrounding you, we will fade quickly. Jesus Christ has to be in your heart. He was in Herod's mind because he put Herod in action. The first thing Herod did, they said, "Hey, where's the king? We come to worship him." He said, "What king?" "Well, the king, we've been following his star." And he gathered all the people that he had assassinated, all the Sanhedrin. Now he brings in the next group of Sanhedrin. He says, "Tell me what your law says." I don't know about you, but I'd just be at this point be like, "Hey, let's tell him what he wants to hear." The last folks that told him the truth. Think about it. The people he had assassinated, now he brings another board in and says, "Tell me about this story." And they say, "Well, the old prophet Micah said there would be a king born and he would be in Bethlehem. That's what Micah said." And so Herod then goes into action. The reason I know he believed in his mind, look what the Bible says there in verse 8. "Who sent the wise men to Bethlehem?" A lot of people think that they're following the star, but who actually sent the wise men to Bethlehem? The "he" here is King Herod. If you read verse 7, it tells you he inquires of Sanhedrin, he inquires of the Jew, he inquires of everyone that has the law of God and says, Where will this king be born? He'll be born in Bethlehem. And then verse 8 said, "And he," King Herod, "sent him to Bethlehem." How in the world could a man believe that there was truly a king born in Bethlehem and took enough action to say, "I may not believe in him, but yet I have a head knowledge that if he's born there and they say he's born, then I'm going to send you there." It tells me he believed with his mind, but he never believed with his heart. Can you know, not only did he believe the message from the religious leaders of the day, but he also believed the messenger's testimony. What was the testimony? Not only did he believe this message of the Word of God, but he believed the messages. We have evidence that says this man believes, it produces action, but again, it's not belief from his heart. He believed in Bethlehem, but he also believed the testimony of the wise men. What was the testimony of the wise men? "We saw a star." And here it is. "At what time did you see his star?" He obviously believed them because in verse 16, God's word says he killed all the children ages 2 and under. Where did he get that number? He had to believe the messengers. My whole life up till I was 23 years old, I would hear my preacher preach. I would hear my Sunday school teachers testify. I would hear godly men and women. I would hear my grandparents talk about their prayer life, talk about how God moved in their life, talk about how God sat down in their house. And I would hear that over and over, and I believed it with my mind, but I couldn't understand it with my heart. I believed their testimonies. I believed their messages. But it wasn't good enough. You will never find Jesus with your mind. You will only find him in your heart. We call Herod wicked. Again, we talked about how cruel he was. But I believe he believed the word of God because he sent him to Bethlehem. He believed the testimony of the wise men because he killed everybody 2 years and under. He believed all the messages. But there was one problem. There's the number 6 that's hidden in the pages there. 6 is the number of miles between Bethlehem and Jerusalem. 6 is also the number that means man. A deteriorating state of man all throughout God's word. In other words, a decaying of man. In other words, man is sinful. In other words, man is essentially going to die without a Savior. The number 6 always represents man, sinful man in the Bible. It's 6 miles from Bethlehem to Jerusalem. 6 is what cost Herod his eternal life. He wasn't willing to travel 6 miles. Watch carefully. It's also about 6 inches from your mind to your heart. 6 inches. It's the number 6. And it continues even today where people will accept Christ here and they figure him out and they think they've got it, but they never accept him here. And the same number 6 that sent Herod, unless he ever found Christ, and there's no history books or no testimonies of that, he's burning in hell all because of the 6, because he couldn't transfer from the mind knowledge of believing the word of God, the mind knowledge of believing the messengers of God, the mind knowledge of what God was trying to do, to the heart knowledge, watch this, to accepting the message. 6. Wow. The number 6. Again, will always represent human weakness and the manifestation of sin. Don't let the 6 inches, the distance of your heart to your mind, destroy your soul. If you don't know Jesus, man, I've been there. I've been there where I believe with my mind and never with my heart. I believe the messengers. I believe the message. But it never went from here to here till I was 23 years old. So you've got to move. It can't be a mind knowledge. It has to be heart knowledge. But number two, you look at the wise men. There must be more than the eyes to see to find Christ. I begin to think of the wise men. The problem with the world today, we're looking for everything. And I get it. We try to understand things. We try to make logic because you and I are humans, right? And so the Bible says God's ways are so much higher than us, but yet we still try to bring God down. We want to rationalize. We want to make sure we understand things. You see, I can't understand how this happens, and I try to rationalize. We've done that since the world began. Man has always tried to discontinue or discount God. For example, if you read history books, they'll say, hey, every 800 years, Saturn and Jupiter line up, but there's this phenomenon every 800 years where Mars also joins them, and it becomes a supernatural-looking star in the sky. This happened in 1603, so an astrologist there, he began to study in 1603 and said, well, then this would have had to happen in 803, and then it would have had to happen in about 3 AD. So this must have been the star that the wise men saw. And I'm good with that. You can read, and there's all kind of logic of what this star may have been. There's all kind of reasoning, and if you look at the worldview of exactly what this may be, could have been, it could have been a comet that passes every 1,200 years, according to astrologies. There's all kind of theories out there, and actually rational, if you just look at it from paper, you go, oh, that makes sense. Oh, that makes sense. But the Bible says in verse 2 there, here's why it's not Mercury and Jupiter and Saturn. It says, we have seen, here is the kicker, where God himself inspired the Word of God to move so that you could understand it. We have seen his star. And then he's going to give us reasons of why his star is not like any other star. Why his star makes a difference in your life and our life. If we know Jesus is the bright morning star, and now Matthew records that this is his star, so you've got the bright and morning star, the day star, our hope, our salvation. You've got his star is one and the same, meaning they all represent Jesus Christ. Then what's so special about this star? Well, the very first thing I noticed, the Bible said we've come from the east, that'd be Persia and Arabia, and it said we've been seeing his star. I believe with all my heart, my walk as a follower of Christ, number one, his star shines the brightest when it first appears. Watch carefully. When it first appears, it will always be the brightest. You say, well, Ray, what are you talking about? I'm talking about these boys, they've started out on an 18 to 24-month journey. Some say 18 months, some say a year, some say 2 years because that's why Herod killed the babies. I'm not here to debate that. All I'm saying is they started out on a long journey. They've packed up all their stuff for 2 years. It'd be like us saying, hey, we're going to take off walking and we're just going to walk for 2 years. Wherever that will take us, I don't know. Some of us, it take us maybe to the Gulf Coast. Some of us, it take us to Canada. I don't know how far you can go in 2 years, all right? It just depends, right? But you take everything that they've got, everything they've done, because this star was so bright, they were able to see it in Arabia when nobody else saw this occurrence. Nobody else was concerned about this. We had somebody come last night to the park, not because of advertisement, not because of Facebook, not because of radio, because they saw these bright lights and wanted to know what was going on. That's exactly what happened to them. This light was so bright, this star was so bright, when they first saw it, it moved on them. There has to be a king there. Why does there have to be a king there? Because you go back 4,000 years all the way till you get to Genesis, and you'll see that a star would rise up out of Judah when the Messiah was come. And they knew that this must be the Savior. This must be the Messiah because it's so bright. It's like unlike anything we've ever seen before. You say, Ray, what do you mean it's the brightest when it first appears? Personal experience, and I pray that you can identify with me. He will always be the brightest when he first appears. When the Word of God rings down, when God illuminates his will in your life, it is bright, you can see it, it's overpowering, you can feel it. And it's the brightest it's ever been. But when you reject the Word of God, when you reject the will of God, when you reject the work of God out of your life, when you reject God that's trying to save your soul, and you keep rejecting Him, the star becomes dimmer and dimmer and dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. When God's trying to move on you, get you to step out, to be more active, to be a better husband, to be a better mother, be a better leader, you reject Him and the star will become dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. When it first appears, when God puts a vision in your heart and in your mind, when it first appears, it's so bright you can see it, you can't wait to do something about it. But the longer you put it off, the longer you put it off, every one of you have a carport, every one of you have a closet. The longer you put it off, the more cluttered that thing gets. You know exactly what I'm talking about, right? It's the same spiritually. God's trying to move in your life. And yet you have the world, the flesh, and Satan is trying to pull you against what God's trying to do. And God has given you this bright vision of ever, however you made a clean up, shore up, correct up. All these things God's trying to give you, and it's very bright, but we keep putting it off. We keep putting it off, and the more we put it off, the farther we walk away from. And then the farther you walk away from any light, it's just common sense. You know, the farther you get from any light, the dimmer it gets. The closer you're drawn to it and the closer you get to it, the brighter it is. Jesus Christ, our bright and morning star, when He begins to shine in your life, specifically just like the wise men, when He has a specific task for you, a specific mission, it will be the brightest you have ever seen when He begins to press on you. And God's given us great visions. Have a vision maybe after the first of the year through testimony of just accountability. How can our church be involved in accountability groups? Those that may have suffered from addictions, but not just addictions from alcohol and drugs. There's addictions from not studying your Word of God, being lazy. There's addictions from not being faithful in God's house. There's addictions not being a disciple in a small group Sunday school. So how can we facilitate an accountability program? Oh, is there one here in our community? Will our community benefit from it? It's a bright star, but is it something that God can get glory from? What about a bright star, Miracle Marietta? 2 years ago, I met with Brother Jeremy and Brother Ron. It's like, hey, man, our kids can't do anything. It's COVID. What can we do? And if I'd have told you 2 years ago, this is what we can do. We can get 815 people in our community so that every one of our churches will be able to touch their hands, be able to put a cup of coffee in their hand or a cup of hot chocolate and say, thank you and Merry Christmas, and put a smile on their face. You'd say, ah, it sounds bizarre. But when that star shined and we began to come together, and Brother Jeremy, we tossed ideas, he and I back and forth, and Brother Ron, we tossed ideas. It was going to be a drive-thru. I said, man, it's going to be a chaos. And we were trying to figure out how you could drive through it because it was COVID. We said, hey, it's outside. If you don't want to be around people, walk on the outside of people. Let's just start here. And we started one thing after another thing after another thing. And the star began to shine bright. And the more you walk through it, the more God gets the glory because of a simple star that was put in the sky, and He asked you to walk through. The miracle in Marietta. I would have never thought it. We had some pictures last night. I was just thinking of how God would use us last night. We had about 815 people. That wasn't last night. That was Jack and Keeley. They're still lovebirds putting Christmas lights up. And just, man, this is all the traffic last night from a security camera. Poor Miss Marie and them, if y'all have an emergency, I don't know how you're going to get out. I'm just kidding, right? But that's looking back. It's just, I grabbed some of these. I should give credit, I guess, to, can't think of his name. What was his name, the photographer that was walking around? Yeah, Chris's brother, exactly. That's exactly what I was going to say. But you just, I was looking at pictures last night. It's just, do you not understand? When it comes to visions these wise men had, when they took off, they're like, it's going to be a two-year journey. You can't quit. Do y'all know how much work is put into that from each church and how much resources? I would love to know how many feet of lights we have. Bob kept saying, how many feet of extension cords we need? I'm like, I sent him a text message. You probably wanted to chew me out. He said, how many feet of extension cord we need? I said, a bunch, B-U-N-C-H. And then Joe said, how many more cords we need? I said, a lot, L-O-T. I mean, I don't know. We just keep hooking up stuff. And then last night about 5:30, we were robbing extension cords, trying to get longer extension cords from one thing. But it takes, there's somebody that's got to put gas in generators. It's the little things that you don't even realize. There's somebody that's got to put gas in those generators. There's some, I mean, it's just little bitty things. But when you begin to see a star, that would be the Word of God symbolizing through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, that speaks to us through the Holy Spirit of God. And you see the star, and it's so bright. You want to help. You want to get involved, because 800 people, I would love to get 800 people at this church at one time. How do you do that? Like, when God gives us that star, we'll do it. But He gave us this. This is how you do it. You represent one church. You lift up one Lord. And you come, and you're unselfish, and you humble yourself. And when we come as a church, all the churches that have participated, that's how you get 800 people to move. That's all. Our Lord and Savior. But there's another star. Many of you, and this will be specifically at our church, many of you either bought a fish plate, ate a fish plate, come got a fish plate, or helped cook fish plates. That's a star. God, it was bright. Hey, this is what we need to do. I was overwhelmed at the support. What is that good for? I tell you what that's good for. Yeah, you ate a piece of fish. We fed over 1,000 kids with that. We provided Christmas for over 1,000 children, because you were willing to stand and cook French fries, put salt on French fries, go get some oil. And by the way, this is also, not only do we provide that, this is the first service in this community here in Palawan. This is our seventh church, East Merida Baptist Church of Palawan. It's the first church service was this week for Christmas. And there we are, handing out gifts. How do you do that? It's not about me. I can't do any of that without you, and we can't do any of that with our Lord and Savior. And we don't know what to do unless He gives us a star, meaning the Word of God and the Spirit of God, to impress on us. And it's the brightest that it's ever been when it begins to shine. Wow. Man, that makes me want to run through a wall. And if you want to see another star, somebody had a star that said, hey, I know who it was, Lacey come and said, can the children do a program? We had like the coolest donkeys and what all other animals I saw up here. And ain't like, you know why it's cool to me? You know why I sat here and wept? It wasn't just the song of giving back. If the least we can do is give ourselves to Him, of the little drummer boy. But we have children to do things with. Those are gifts from God for us to not neglect, but to praise Him for, to invest in Him. So that one day when I'm not standing here, one of those little dudes, I'm pretty sure it's going to be this one that was over there. He kept wanting to get to Jesus. You know he's going to be a preacher, right? I mean, I don't know who it'll be. Oh, church, it's a star. Somebody had the vision to come and said, let's do this. Let's do this. Somebody has to play the piano. Somebody has to sing. Let's do this. It starts with a small vision. The star is the brightest when it first appears. Now let me go ahead and, I don't want to preach to you, I want to preach at me. I'm also, I'll be honest enough to say, in my 20 years as a Christian, December the 31st, which is coming up, no, it'll be 23 years. There's been times where God has appeared as a star, bright, shining. You know what I said, Kobe? It's too much work. It's going to take too much effort. I don't have enough money. I don't have enough resources. And that star slowly faded. At times like that, I stopped. God, I'm sorry. I know what you're wanting to do. There's a loved one in the hospital. Someone needing at the funeral home, needing a hug. Too busy. The star slowly had dim. That's why I'm grateful for times like this. Say, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. You keep shining. I'll keep being obedient. Forgive me where I failed you in the past. When the shine star, when you first see it, it's going to be the brightest. The longer you put it off. And every one of you in here, I don't know, including myself, what God's trying to do in your life. But you do. I don't have to stand here and say, look inside yourself. You know. You know exactly what God's trying to get you to do. You know. Don't let His star go dim. The star is the brightest when it first comes up. But this is how I also know that it wasn't planets or wasn't a regular star that we see. Because not only was it brightest than any other star, but according to the Word of God, and this is my point, it continues to move you to where God is wanting you or is calling you. If you notice there with the wise men, this star was not stationary. Now, the Bible says there in Matthew chapter 2 that it reappeared to them after they left Jerusalem. I'm guilty of this. Oftentimes when I see a star and I know what God's wanting us to do, Stan, then all of a sudden I go back to reasoning, and I believe the wise men did too. Where would a king be born in Israel? Where is the kingdom set up at? Where is the king's city at? Jerusalem. If it's going to be a king born, it must be the son of the existing king. So Ted, by reason, we'll just go to Jerusalem looking for him. Wouldn't that be logic? And they went to see. They thought everybody would be paying homage. Where's the king? And Herod's like, what are you talking about? All of Jerusalem was all in up. What are they talking about? Go and find the prophets. Go and find the word of God. Oh, it's going to be in Bethlehem. And watch this. And when they started in Bethlehem, the Bible says the star reappeared and went before them. And here it is. And came and stood over the house that Jesus was at. I don't care what kind of, if you can use logic, if you want to use the planets, if you want to use the stars that are existing, no doubt the word of God, just like the cloud that led them from the desert, it was not stationary. It was not because it was a rain cloud. It was actually a cloud given by God for the children of Israel for shade, for protection, and then a guide. This star not only appeared before them, but guided them and led them. If you want to follow someone that will guide you and lead you so that you'll have peace, so that you'll have comfort, so you'll know exactly where God is wanting you, it will come and it will stop exactly to the place that God is calling you to work if you would keep your eyes on it. But if you're looking with your rational eyes, you're going to say, oh, Jerusalem's where the king's supposed to be. You cannot find Jesus Christ with your physical eyeballs or your rational brain. It has to be with by faith of the eyeballs, spiritual eyes, and of the heart. Someone said, Bethlehem is poor. It's the least. Yeah. Do you really think he's going to be there? Yeah. Yeah, because I'm looking by faith. We go to Bethlehem. The star reappears. His star guides them. It is a supernatural event that God is illustrating so that the Scriptures might fulfill the prophecy, so that from Genesis to Revelation, there's never a contradiction, so that whoever pen Moses 4,000 years ago will line up with the testimony of Matthew. Think about that just for a second. The only way all this lines up is if there's one author, which means there has to be one God, one author. And we continue to move. Where is God calling you? The star, again, just like a cloud. So my question I'm going to challenge you with, stop looking around and keep your eyes locked on Jesus, the bright and morning star. He will guide you. And finally, the wise men come. Can you imagine what their testimony was when they got back home? Hey, what's their testimony when they got back home? What do you tell people? Hey, did you find what you were looking for? Did you find the king? Oh, yeah. Now, I want you to listen carefully at my words. How did you find the king? I found him by following his word, his star. His star comes from Genesis. It is then magnified in Micah. All throughout the psalm, you see prophecy of Jesus coming, the Messiah. We just followed the star. What'd you do when you got there? And I know the three wise men we get from the three gifts, not necessarily the men. But I'm going to use the ones that had the gift. There's three gifts, right? Stan, one of them would have said, well, I tell you what I did. I followed that star, and it led me to my king. And I wanted to pay homage to him. And so the gift that I brought was gold, because that's for kings. And I laid it at his feet, and I worshiped him. Wow. How about you, sir? Well, I followed the star, his words. And it led me to my God. What? So I brought the gift of frankincense, which was used in worship. And I wanted to bring my God and pay my God, homage. And so I sit frankincense down at his feet. What about you, sir? He paid homage to his king. He paid homage to his God. But I wanted to bring a gift for my Savior. The only way you can be a great Savior is you'll have to be a great sufferer. And so I brought him the gift of myrrh, which was used to embalm dead people, and knew that he would be a great sufferer. And I laid myrrh down at his feet, and following the star, I found my Savior. I found my King. I found my God. And I found my Savior. All from following the star. All from following the star. The star, the Word of God, will take what you believe here and bring it here. This star, following the Word of God, will take what you see here and allow you to see it here. I pray today, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, or I pray if God's star is bright and you know God is calling you, impressing on you to change, correct, whatever it may be, I pray today that you would simply, like the wise men, pay homage, bow down in worship, my God, my King, my Savior. Would you bow your heads? Father, love you today. I thank you. I pray, Father, that you would just absolutely move through the sanctuary here today. I pray, Father, start with me. What star, God, meaning your words, are you highlighting in my life? God, what role, what mission, what work? God, when it shines the bright, let me not reject it. And God, I pray in this building, Father, we'd be willing to worship you, our God, our King, our Savior this morning. Lord, if there's someone that don't know you, moving from the head to the heart, they may believe you just like Herod did. And that belief even may have caused action so that we even come to church. We even act like we're praying. I pray today, though, Father, that humble themselves, give their heart to you. God, you do the convicting and the correction. Let us be obedient to your words. Let your star shine bright. I do pray. In Jesus' name I pray, and all of us said, amen. Church, would you stand with me? Whatever God has impressed on your heart, would you be obedient this morning? He is the star, the bright and morning star. all God's people sin. Listen, church, a little burden on my heart. I know many of us got family that's sick, battling cancer. Others have personal problems that maybe we don't want to share public, family issues. And we're all in this together. We're doing life together. But following Christ is not easy. You don't think the devil wants to tear apart your family, your testimony, your ministry? Oh, he's not trying to tear you apart. He's already got you. Promise. So would you do me a favor? I don't know where you're sitting. Just would you pray for whoever's sitting beside you? Just put your hand on their back or whatever. Let's all pray for each other. We're going to go and we're going to complete this mission. And we've got 2 days. Let's pray while you're praying for that person. Pray. Seeds be planted at our Miracle Marietta. We're not doing this for anybody, but for our Lord and Savior. But I know many of you, just for you coming and asking for prayers, you have needs. My mother's aunt passed this week. She was 99. The last surviving son of my mother's family's hurting. Would you lift up them? Let's spend just a minute praying for each other. Pray for Miss Rita. Don't forget Miss Rita. She's in the hospital. Miss Sally, who's continue to lift up. Lord, you know all our hearts. God, I know when we confess our sins to each other, more importantly, God, when we hold each other up, intercede for each other, our load gets lighter. We're able to continue one more day. So I lift up my brother. I lift up my sister here. I lift up those, God, that are in the hospital. Those, God, that are struggling. I lift them up, Father. I hold them up, God. Those that are, God, you know every need. I lift them up. I lift them up to you. God, let us celebrate Christmas and not be distracted by the world, because I know everything that's happening is a distraction from you. So God, let us keep our eyes focused on you. Forgive us of where we failed you. Let us look to the star, your words, God, as we celebrate Christmas. In Jesus' name I pray, and all of us said, amen and amen. Hey, church, we're going to meet 2 o'clock. We'll have a meeting at 4 o'clock at the pavilion. Some of us have been there at 2 o'clock. We've got to get all the golf carts gassed up, all the generators gassed up. Anthony, play us out, fella. What's going on?